Scientists are always asking the question, how do we know? Where is the evidence? What is the rock bottom empirical justification for what you're telling me? At this point, we've seen a number of different rate constants for various energy transfer processes and talked about some mathematical models that describe or explain how the rate of energy transfer depends on a number of factors. And you may have asked yourself on numerous occasions, how do we know? How do we know what all these rate constants are? How do we know this mathematical model is robust? In this video, we're going to talk about Stern-Volmer analysis, which is an important, very important experimental technique for assessing the rate constants of energy transfer processes, quenching processes in general, whether we're talking about energy transfer or chemical reaction. And so it's applied extremely broadly to do one of two things: either provide a quantitative measure of the rate constant of a quenching process, or to simply provide evidence that a reaction is taking place, a reaction of an excited state with a molecule that is quenching it is taking place. So here we're going to look at Stern-Volmer analysis in detail, derive the Stern-Volmer relation, and talk about the information we can get from a Stern-Volmer plot, which is sort of the empirical centerpiece of Stern-Volmer analysis. The basic idea of a Stern-Volmer analysis is to measure the dependence of the fluorescence or phosphorescence associated with an excited state, be it a singlet in the case of fluorescence or a triplet in the case of phosphorescence, the dependence of those intensities on the concentration of a quencher. And the starting point for understanding Stern-Volmer analysis is really this mechanistic scheme that you see on this slide. And to understand this, we're just thinking in very broad terms about what an excited state can do. The first step is generation of the excited state through absorption of a photon by M to form M star, the excited state. This is absorption, and it has a rate that is proportional to the concentration of M and the concentration of photons, that does matter, impinging on the sample, on the solution, for example, as well as the intrinsic rate constant for absorption. Now, what can the excited state M star do from there? Three basic things. It can engage in fluorescence. Here we're focusing on the simpler picture of fluorescence Stern-Volmer analysis, although phosphorescence Stern-Volmer analysis is not that much more complicated. We just incorporate ISC. But for analysis of a singlet state, that singlet state can fluoresce. It can engage in other decay pathways, any other unimolecular decay pathway, internal conversion, inter-system crossing, etc., or it can be quenched. And that involves a bimolecular reaction of M star with Q to form M and Q star. Now, let's talk about the rates of each of these three processes that the excited state can do. The rate of fluorescence is equal to the rate constant for emission times the concentration of the excited state, M star. For the other decay pathways, the idea is very similar. We just have different rate constants for each of the individual decay pathways, one for inter-system crossing, one for internal conversion, etc., etc. And the concentration dependence on M star is still there, of course, since these are first order in M star. The quenching process is bimolecular, and so the rate expression for the quenching process includes the rate constant of quenching, which we're going to call KQ, very important quantity and one that we're trying to measure here, times the concentration of M star times the concentration of Q. And an important thing to note about this mechanistic scheme is that we can distinguish the first step fundamentally from the other three. The first step involves the generation of the excited state, while the remaining three steps involve consumption of the excited state. If we set up our system such that the concentration of the excited state is not changing with time, we can take advantage of a steady state approximation, setting the rate of generation of the excited state M star equal to the sum of the rates of consumption of M star for each of these possible processes. And this is very much a starting point for understanding Stern-Volmer analysis. Where we're going from here involves thinking about the quantum yield of emission, in the case we're looking at here, fluorescence, as a function of the concentration of the quenchers. So let's just start by asking, what is the quantum yield of emission given all of these various rates that we've talked about so far? First, we'll define a rate constant KD, which is the total rate constant of decay, deactivation of our excited state. It is the sum of the rate constant for emission plus the rate constant for all those other decay processes that are non-radiative. Defining this KD is going to be useful for us here in a second. I should also add here that KD and all of these processes embedded within it refer to unimolecular decay mechanisms. So we're excluding quenching from this KD value. It refers only to unimolecular decay. Now we ask the question, what is the quantum yield for fluorescence, or more generally for emission? Well, we've talked about the idea that quantum yield is a probability. And when we talk about rates, we can also think of the ratios of rate constants as a kind of probability. In the case of an excited state, it has available to it, in the presence of a quencher, generally speaking, two different things it can do: unimolecular decay, as summed up in this rate constant KD, and quenching by the quencher, which is captured by this second term, which we can represent as bimolecular decay, or bimolecular quenching. This total is the total decay rate of the excited state. K emission is only one aspect of this total. Notice that it is embedded in KD. But the ratio of the rate of K emission to the total rate of things that can get rid of or deactivate or cause the excited state to decay is a measure of the probability of emission taking place. Imagine I'm pulling coins out of my wallet, and the rate of pennies I'm pulling out is 1 per minute, but the rate of coins I'm pulling out is 1 per second. That indicates that the probability of my pulling out a penny, right, is 1 in 60, since I only get 1 penny for every 60 seconds. Same idea here with quantum yield. If my rate of emission is 1 per nanosecond, but my total rate of disappearance of the excited state is 10 per nanosecond, the probability of emission is 1 in 10. The quantum yield of emission is 1 in 10. I hope this helps you see how we can represent quantum yield as a ratio of rate constants. And it's the rate constant for our process of interest divided by the total rate constant for all processes that can cause the excited state to disappear, including unimolecular decay, as summed up in this KD term, and bimolecular decay, or bimolecular quenching, which is summed up in this KQ times Q term. Now, what can we do with this? Well, what happens when there is no quencher present? The KQ times the molarity of Q term disappears, since the molarity of Q is 0 in that case. And so we can think about the quantum yield of emission in the absence of quencher is simply K of emission divided by KD, right? Let's actually write that out explicitly so that we understand that. The quantum yield of emission in the absence of quencher, which is what that 0 represents, is simply equal to the rate constant of emission divided by the total rate constant for unimolecular decay of the excited state, KD. Combining this expression with the one right above it and setting up a ratio leads to this equation at the bottom of the slide. The ratio of the quantum yield of emission in the absence of quencher to the quantum yield of emission in the presence of quencher at concentration Q is equal to KD plus KQ times that concentration of Q divided by KD. And this simplifies to 1 KD divided by KD plus KQ divided by KD times the molarity of Q. Now let's pause and think about what this is saying. If I can measure the quantum yield of emission in the absence of quencher, which is a quantum yield measurement experiment that we'll talk about when we talk about experimental techniques in photochemistry in a future video series, if I can measure that quantum yield and measure the quantum yield again in the presence of quencher, I can measure this ratio. I know the molarity of quencher because I can do stoichiometry and set up the solution with the molarity of Q as desired. And if I know the total rate constant for unimolecular decay of the excited state, which again can be determined from lifetime measurements, then the only unknown in this equation becomes KQ. So doing these quantum yield measurements as a function of the molarity of Q allows me to determine KQ in combination with lifetime experiments associated with the excited state by itself in the absence of quencher. So another way we express this equation in the bottom left converts 1 over KD into the lifetime tau m star for the excited state m star. So just to highlight that, the reason this appears right here in this version of the Stern-Volmer relation is that this lifetime, what I'm calling here tau m star, is equal to 1 over kd, where kd is, as we've defined it previously, the sum of the radiative and non-radiative unimolecular decay rate constants for m star. It's very common that we know that, or we can measure that from experiments. We can measure the quantum yields and thereby determine the rate constant for quenching. And this is where all those energy transfer rate constants come from, by and large. Stern-Volmer measurements involving the combination of an excited state with a quencher. One of the cool things about the Stern-Volmer relation also is that we don't need to measure quantum yields, which, as we'll see later, is a bit of a pain. We only need to measure fluorescence intensity, and the exact same relation applies. I will not go through the details, but I0 and I here are, in the case we've been discussing so far with a singlet state, fluorescence intensities, although more generally emission intensities, we might say. We look at emission intensity in the absence of quencher, emission intensity in the presence of quencher. I will be less than I0 when the molarity of Q is greater than zero. In other words, when the quencher is present, the intensity of emission will decrease. And from that idea, we can get a measure of the rate constant for quenching or the lifetime, if we know the rate constant of quenching and we want to get a measure of the lifetime from this. So these two equations in the yellow boxes are referred to as the Stern-Volmer relations. As we've stated, the key idea here, really the centerpiece of it all, is this KQ value. That is what we're going for very often in a Stern-Volmer analysis. Sometimes we want to just show that the excited state is being consumed by Q. And experimental data with a linear dependence of I0 over I, for example, on the molarity of Q gives great evidence that the quencher Q is in fact engaging with the excited state M star. And lastly, let's just remind ourselves that this equation holds for any quenching mechanism. Energy transfer, electron transfer, and even photochemical reactions of Q with M star. That's a double-edged sword. It allows Stern-Volmer analysis to be applied in a variety of contexts, but it diminishes the amount of information we can get out of a Stern-Volmer analysis. For example, we can't tell whether the mechanism of quenching is energy transfer, electron transfer, or a reaction from a Stern-Volmer analysis alone, right? Since any of these three quenching mechanisms would lead to the same shape of the data, essentially, would still lead to a linear Stern-Volmer plot, as we'll see on the next slide. So as we said, what we do in a Stern-Volmer experiment is measure the quantum yield of emission as a function of the molarity of the quencher. If the Stern-Volmer relation holds, a plot of phi 0 over phi for emission as a function of the molarity of Q will be linear. The intercept will be 1.0 because of this 1 in the Stern-Volmer equation. And the slope of the line, check this out, the slope of the line will be equal to the rate constant of quenching times the lifetime of M star. And briefly, I'll just mention, how do we measure the lifetime of M star? Very simple. We simply look at some measure that is proportional to the molarity of M star in solution. And I'll just leave this general by just saying we're measuring something that is proportional to the molarity of M star. For example, the fluorescence intensity after some burst of excitation that generates a large concentration of M star as a function of time. And this will decay typically exponentially. And the lifetime for exponential decay is essentially the point at which M star concentration reaches 1 over E with respect to where it started. So somewhere along the lines of 35-ish% or so corresponds to the lifetime of M star, this tau value. So that's a separate experiment where no quencher is involved and we're following, for example, the fluorescence emission of M star as a function of time. But it's a very simple experiment to perform nowadays and one that easily supplies these lifetime measurements. And nowadays, lifetimes have been tabulated for a wide variety of organic compounds. Knowing that allows us to determine KQ, the rate constant for quenching. And so the big things we get out of this Stern-Volmer plot are, first of all, evidence for some interaction between M star and Q, sometimes establishing that there is an interaction is an important piece of experimental evidence to rule out alternative, for example, non-photochemical mechanisms. It can give us the rate constant for quenching or reaction, although we have to be careful about distinguishing between the different possible mechanisms of quenching that could be going on through other experiments. And we will not get into the details here, but non-linear Stern-Volmer plots, suggests that interesting things are going on. For example, the involvement of both singlet and triplet states in a reaction mechanism for a photochemical reaction can lead to a nonlinear Stern-Volmer plot. I can refer you to some resources in the video description on nonlinear Stern-Volmer plots, but we will not wade into the details of those for this course. Finally, I'll mention that you can try Stern-Volmer analysis yourself by clicking on this link. This will take you to a Chem LibreText page where you can follow through the background and instructions here to do a mini Stern-Volmer analysis on the set of data provided here and follow the exercises to carry out an analysis all by yourself.